Well, good morning. We started on a very spirited way this morning, and I don't know whether I'll be able to carry on by the same tempo. I'm delighted to be here. I'm always happy to be in Namibia, as I was saying to someone earlier on today. This is one of the loveliest places I've lived in Africa. And I was part of the creation of the University of Namibia. Like, I was the first person who was drafted by the then Vice Chancellor designate, Peter Kachavivi, to help him to establish the new university, what is become the University of Namibia. So it's always very pleasant to be here. I'm also happy, very happy to see somebody I haven't seen for 16 years. I met him as a youngster who just started university studies in Heidelberg, and where I taught many years back. And his father was my friend. His father was working for the German, for the DSC, those speaking for Ethiopia. And he was a struggling youngster then. I remember he came to visit me in South Africa. Now I see him here, he's become a bit like his father. There can be no doubt about the fact that he's his father's son. not only biologically, but also culturally. And it was a very, very pleasant experience to see him also moving, climbing up fast in the same trajectory that his father worked. I don't see him here this morning, but I suspect he's embedded somewhere in this month before me. My mission this morning to you is to provoke your minds about some of the work that is going on around ICTs that we're doing. When the Honourable Minister started off this morning, he greeted everybody in languages very far flung from Africa. He went into Portuguese, and French, and German, and Spanish, and I don't know what. He never greeted us in a single African language. Now, I ask myself, if we go to China, if we have a meeting like this in China, will that happen?
No.
If we did it in India, in Hyderabad, will that happen? If we did it in Japan, will that happen? Why is it that the minister in Africa stands in front of people who are half his own people who speak languages that he speaks from his own mother tongue, and he chooses to greet only those who want to be greeted in German, French, Portuguese? Why? Now, that malaise is what I want to discuss with you this morning, in as far as it affects the enterprise of ICT's production, usage, etc. And see whether I can draw some attention to some deep problems that are inherent in this situation of not utilizing the languages of Africa. The UNESCO, fortunately, increasingly since about the late 50s, 60s, 70s, and 80s, since the Mexico meeting, the Moyne Accords meeting, and the announcements they made, that the UNESCO is increasingly emphasizing this point. But I don't think that in our practice we are moving forward as sensitively as we need to if we want to prosper with it, if we want to make more money with it, if we want the thing to blossom and be expanded completely, then we need to pay attention to the question of the languages in which we work. ICTs are becoming, and I'm not going to bore you with too much detail about that, because you know much more about those things than I do. ICTs have become leading parts of a culture of the developed societies of the world, consuming as much as producing this technologies, developing smarter chips, tablets, iPads, iPhones, which can do more and more and still more to come. However, technologized knowledge-based societies of today do not simply consume technology. They even more crucially, they produce technologies. They expend the product, use the product, but also, more importantly, they have the capacity to create new technology with added value. They effectively capitalize on congealed knowledge. Thus, the ability to both produce and consume ICTs is not universal. In Africa, we consume, we do not produce ICTs. Now this is what I want to provoke you by this way. In Africa, we consume, we do not produce. Now this way of operating in Africa has been going on for centuries. We've been working like this. And the way we do it then is that we dig deeper into the earth and unearth stuff which nobody else can find anywhere in the world. And we sell it for a pittance, and we buy stuff from outside. We never learn to produce things we need. And it's a question of language. In a recent report by the World Bank and the African Development Bank, with support from the African Union, it was suggested that ICT innovations are delivering homegrown and societally appropriate solutions in Africa, transforming business practices and driving entrepreneurial skills and economic growth. We are informed that Africa's mobile phones market has in the last 5 years climbed to 650 million subscribers. This means that it's bigger than either the United States or the European Union. Remarkably, the number of mobile phones in Africa has grown 40-fold since 2000. At the same time, internet bandwidth has grown 20-fold, as hundreds of thousands of kilometers of new cables have been laid across the continent to serve increasingly larger numbers. The report argues that the new access is rapidly transforming our lives, driving business, fueled in part by collaborative technology hubs, and delivering innovation and homegrown solutions for Africa. This is what the report is saying. Tim Kelly, and I hope it's not here, a lead ICT policy specialist at the World Bank, and an author of the report, in addition, suggests that, and I quote, Africa is rapidly becoming an ICT leader. Innovations that began in Africa, like dual SIM, SIM card, mobile phones, or using mobile phones for remittance payments, are now spreading across the continent and beyond. Unquote. Kelly's assertions are a bit misleading. They provide succor and cheer for a dispirited, elementally dispirited Africans. Many Africans are too ready and delighted to hear glowing observations made about them. If even these are untrue, Kelly indeed overstates his claims. Africans do not produce mobile phones. We only use them. The knowledge base and infrastructure to do this is currently absent in African societies. The spectacular success in the use of cell phones in Africa in comparison to other parts of the world is because economically they are within reach and they fill an enormous gap in communications in Africa. Where in other parts of the world computers and land-based telephones are available, in Africa these latter are relatively in short supply and for many very expensive. The shortfall is covered by the profusion of economically accessible cell phones. Because cell phones now are very relatively cheap. Africans in all areas of technological production, including ICTs, lag behind other parts of the world. It is my suggestion that this is a serious cultural deficit. The incapacity to produce technologies in comparative terms to other parts of the world is a weakness of Africa's technological culture in general, and language as a key element of culture in particular. In Africa and some parts of the underdeveloped world, this technological and scientific vacuity sometimes, in response, triggers a type of cargo cult science. Innovations which claim to be scientific, but which in actual fact are based on pseudoscience, willful deception, and fantasy. Through which, the desperate wish to replicate relatively advanced technological goods is left to religion, magic, and blessing to be effectuated. I can give you an example of an apostolic pastor in Ghana called Kwejosa, who claims every now and then to be manufacturing some high-tech stuff. This man never saw the inside of a secondary school completely. But he claims he can make radios, cell phones, cars, four-wheel drive. It's a cargo cult mentality. After 244 years, the publishers of Encyclopedia Britannica announced just this month that they are bringing the production of the 32-volume print version of the Encyclopedia to a close. They are going fully online, and already 85% of their clientele access the entire encyclopedia online. They indicate also that for several years they've seen this development approaching. All of this is of course progress. But progress for whom? The majority of Africans who could benefit from the encyclopedia do not have computers and are not really in a position on the basis of cost to access this material through their mobile phones. But even more importantly, how many Africans have mastery of the English language sufficiently to be able to benefit from these transformations? In other words, in whose language and for which audience is this technological jump meant to serve? Language is a primary instrument for communicating information and knowledge. And as I've said earlier on, the UNESCO has consistently, of all the big bodies, compared with the World Bank, the IMF, any of these, OECD, it's the UNESCO which shows consistency and fidelity to the ideals of creating a world in which access to the internet and ICTs is available to all, and available to all in good measure. They insist all the time on letting diversity appear on the internet. Diversity not only in consumption, but also in production. They draw attention to the fact that the production user and the product user and the producer should be in a constant state of dialogue. Now, language is important also, because no society on earth progresses on the basis of somebody else's language. No society progresses on the basis of a language which is used by maximum 10% of its population, like here. Like the display we saw from the minister of his access and ability to greet people in European languages. No society makes progress like that. All societies which are making progress, like the societies in Asia, which we see, all former colonial societies like Vietnam, like Indonesia, like Malaysia, are doing it on the basis of their own languages, for heaven's sake. They are not trying to compete with Shakespeare in his language. And this is in even small countries like the Netherlands, where I lived for many years, Iceland, with 300,000 people, work on the internet in their own languages. That doesn't stop them from learning English or French or any other language, or increasingly Mandarin. But they work primarily in their, they can produce technology in their languages, and they can use technology in their languages. So please, let's not be silent about this. You are experts from all corners of the world, connected with some of the most important institutions and businesses involved in this field. Please take this message seriously. Microsoft or Dell, Hewlett Packard, all of you, take it seriously. If you want also to make your profits, you have to work in depth with the people, not just superficially counting numbers who can use mobile phones. So this is my message. It's a message about the language. Let's go.